Assalamu alaikum, I'm Saadat Nisar with the course Electronic Commerce. If you recall, we were discussing the concept cryptography in our previous lecture. Let's have a little bit of review what we did last time in this regard. I told you that cryptography is defined as a collection of mathematical techniques which are utilized to make certain information as confidential. So wherever we want that our information should be converted into an unintelligible format, we can apply cryptography technique in this behalf. And there are two terms which I refer to. One is encryption and the other decryption. Encryption is the process of scrambling a piece of information. So wherever we apply cryptography and as a result the information becomes scrambled, we say that the process of encryption has taken place. The reverse of encryption is decryption. So by applying an appropriate cryptographic key, when we convert our coded information back to an information which is in the understandable format, we say that we have decrypted the information. Then the term key, if you recall, I told that keys are those randomly generated set of characters. They may be in the form of digits, letters, special characters or a combination thereof. Keys are generated with the help of cryptographic algorithms. And once these keys have been generated, then we can apply those to encrypt or decrypt the data. Cryptography is mainly divided into two types. So symmetric cryptography and asymmetric cryptography, these are the two main types. In symmetric cryptography, the same key is used for encryption and decryption. On the other hand, in case of asymmetric cryptography, a pair of keys is utilized for encryption and decryption purposes. We call them public and private keys. So whatever information we encrypt with the help of a public key, the same information can then be decrypted using the corresponding private key alone. We'll study this concept in more detail in our today's lecture, inshallah. Then PGP, if you recall, I told that PGP stands for Pretty Good Privacy, and it is a very famous cryptographic system which is available for general public use. And it was developed by a German, Phil Zimmermann, somewhere in 1991. And today it is one of the most popular cryptographic systems. It uses both the symmetric and the asymmetric type of cryptography. Next, the term digital signatures or electronic signatures I referred to in our previous lecture. I refresh your memory by repeating the definition. A digital signature is defined as any letter, symbol, character, number, or a combination thereof, which can be applied to an electronic document, say an email, and it serves three purposes. In other words, a digital signature has three main characteristics. What are those? These are authenticity, integrity, and non-repudiation. So I repeat, authenticity means that with the help of the digital signature, we can trace the source of the information from where some information has been sent. We can track that source, and that is called authenticity. Then integrity means that with the help of digital signatures, this is the characteristic of digital signatures, that we can determine that as to whether this particular piece of information was altered or modified during transmission or not. So there is a particular logic, there is a technique, I'll teach you that in our today's lecture, how we can ensure the integrity with the help of digital signatures. Any set of characters, letters, digits, etc., which provide us authenticity, integrity, non-repudiation, we can term them as digital signatures. Remember, normally the digital signatures, they are applied with the help of the private key. Okay, you have to keep this thing in mind that in order to create a digital signature, we use private key. Then non-repudiation, the third characteristic, basically it is a consequence of the earlier two properties. So wherever the authenticity and integrity they have been ensured, then non-repudiation would automatically come in. Non-repudiation means that a person who is supposed to be a signatory of the digital signatures, he cannot subsequently deny, he cannot refuse that these are not his signatures. The technology is so sound that it is nearly impossible for somebody to later on repudiate or deny the execution of the signatures which are associated with that individual. Okay, with this brief overview about the term cryptography, encryption, decryption, digital signatures, then let me show you a few slides which can illustrate this concept, encryption, decryption, to make you more acquainted with the idea. So you can see in the slide, there is some plain text. Plain text means some text, some information which is in the understandable format. It is not in the coded format. We apply a cryptographic key on that plain text. The cryptographic key is generated by some encryption algorithm. There are various encryption algorithms. We'll talk about that later. So with the help of an encryption algorithm, some key may be generated. When this cryptographic key is applied on the plain text, that plain text is then converted into unintelligible format or in a scrambled format. And we call that scrambled information as cipher text, as you can see on the slide. And then underneath you can see the arrow, the process of conversion of plain text into cipher text. We call that encryption. And then the arrow, which is at the bottom, that indicates decryption. Decryption takes place when the ciphertext is used, and on the ciphertext the key is applied, which results into the conversion of that ciphertext back to plain text. So by applying the appropriate key, when our coded information, our scrambled information, is converted back to the information which is understandable, which is plain text, we call that process as decryption. Again, we require a key for decryption purposes. In the next slide, you can see that I'm trying to explain the use of public and private keys. So there is some original message, some plain text. With the help of the encryption algorithm, we have a key. And that key here is specifically referred to as recipient's public key. Recipient, or the receiver of the message, his public key is applied on the original message. Consequently, the message is then encrypted with the public key of that receiver. And this encrypted message is then delivered to the receiver. On the receiver's end, once the receiver picks up this confidential encrypted message, Again, with the help of some decryption algorithm, there is a key generated. That key would be here referred to as the receiver's or recipient's secret or private key. So with the help of receiver's private key, the receiver would decrypt this information and the original message would be available for view to the receiver. So notice here, you must register this thing in mind in order to comprehend the concept that whatever information we have encrypted with the help of the public key of the receiver, only the corresponding private key of the receiver can decrypt that message. This is the basic thing. Whatever information you want to send to a particular person, you will always use that person's public key and encrypt that information with his public key, and on his receiver's side, that receiver would apply his secret or the private key to decrypt that information. Here you should also register that the public key is not a secret thing. This key is publicly known, it is publicly available. On the other hand, the private key is a secret key. It is only supposed to be known to the receiver. It is only available with the receiver. He should have the knowledge of it alone. Then, in the subsequent slide, I'm just trying to give you an impression as to how we can apply the digital signature. Assume there is a message. We write this message. We encrypt this message also. And now, after encrypting the message, say we want to sign this message digitally. In order to do that, the sender of the message would use his secret key, that is the private key, and he would apply his private key on certain pattern of numbers or digits. We call that a message digest. Here you can see 00101001. This is the binary form of that number, the message digest. I'll explain this concept later in detail what a message digest is. For the time being, you should know that when the sender enters or inserts his private key in the message digest, it results into a digital signature. In other words, the message has now been signed with the digital signature. Again, notice that the private key of the sender is being used here to create the digital signature. Then this digitally signed message is delivered to the receiver, and the receiver, in order to verify these digital signatures, would use the sender's public key now. Remember, the sender's public key is not a secret thing. It is publicly known, available. So, using the sender's public key then, applying that sender's public key on the digital signature, some decryption would take place. It should take place, and the message digest should again be revealed, which would confirm that this signature belongs to a particular sender. Okay, with this background in mind, let's talk about two terms which are very fundamental to understand the digital signature technology. One is digital certificates, and the other is certification authority. The digital certificate is defined to be that certificate in electronic format which establishes the association of an individual with his or her corresponding public key. Here, the word is public key. So, any document in electronic format that establishes, that creates a linkage between an individual and his corresponding public key, and it is signed by a certification authority, by an organization, with the help of that certification authority's private key, we can say that a digital certificate has come into existence. I'll talk about the certification authority very shortly. A digital certificate mainly comprises the identification information of a user, the name of the user, the ID of the user, etc. Plus, it also contains the public key which has been assigned to that individual, to that user. And as I mentioned earlier, this information, this certificate should then be digitally signed by a reputed certification authority, an organization, with the help of its private key. So wherever there is a digital certificate which has been signed by a certification authority, that can lead us to the proof that this public key, which is specified on the certificate, that belongs to this particular individual whose name is appearing on the certificate. The digital certificates, they are normally issued in a standard format. Normally, X509 standard format is worldwide used for the issuance of digital certificates. It has got its prescribed fields. So the date of issuance, the date of expiry, the name, the public key, all these fields would be available in the X509 standard format, and they would contain the relevant information. Just to give you some idea how a digital certificate looks like, I can show you a slide. You can see on the screen. So here is the example of a digital certificate. Name, say Kamran Ahmed, public key, and there is a set of numbers. You can see 0, 2, 3, 9, 1, 7, 9, etc. This particular public key associated with this individual, Kamran Ahmed, is in terms of digits. It is in terms of numbers. The public key can be in different format also. It can be in terms of letters. It can be a combination of letters and numbers and special characters. There are various different formats available. In this particular case, the public key is in the number format. And then the date of issue of the certificate, that is specified 15 January 2003, and then the date of expiry 15th January 2005, and then there is a serial number you can see referring to this digital certificate. So there is a number 2, 3, 4, 5, 8, so on, in relation to this digital certificate. At the bottom, you see the certification, the statement, we certify that the above information is true. And then there is the name of that organization called the certification authority here, that CA is Alpha Certification Authority. And then this certification authority, with the help of its private key, would digitally sign this certificate. You are not viewing that signature of this CA here in this particular example, but you can assume that this certificate would be signed by the CA, which is in this case Alpha Certification Authority. I had just talked about the term certification authority, or abbreviated as CA. What is that? Remember, a certification authority is defined as that public or private body, public private organization, that attests the association of an individual with his or her corresponding public key using a digital certificate. In other words, a certification authority would issue the digital certificates. It can issue the, it can generate the keys for us, and then after that it can certify the public key which has been associated with a particular individual, which has been assigned to a particular individual. There are many certification authorities which are working worldwide. They are in operation today. One of the most prominent, in fact the pioneering certification authority in the world, is VeriSign. it is an America-based organization, VeriSign, and it is very well reputed certification authority. The certificates that VeriSign has issued, they carry a lot of weightage, they carry a lot of trust attached to them. These certification authorities, they operate in a hierarchical manner. In other words, they operate in a hierarchy. So the certification authority that is at the top of the hierarchy, that is the most well-reputed certification authority, we call that the root certification authority, root CA. Under the root CA, there would be certain CAs working, and maybe under those certification authorities, then there are certain further CAs which are operating, and so on. The root certification authority sits at the top of the hierarchy, and it can issue the digital certificates to all those certification authorities which operate underneath it. And by issuing those digital certificates to those CAs, it can authenticate, it can confirm those public keys which are associated with those certification authorities. In the similar manner, the certification authorities which have received the certificates from the root CA, they can then further issue the digital certificates to those CAs which operate under them. So in this particular manner, the hierarchy of CAs that can come into existence. Each CA would be issuing a digital certificate confirming the public key of a CA that would be operating underneath. So I can show you a slide here to illustrate this concept of hierarchy of CAs. You can notice at the top there is a root certificate authority that should be the most reputed certification authority. And then in this particular example, there are two CAs which operate under it, that is CA2 and CA4. Then under CA2, there is further a certification authority, that is CA1. And then CA1 has issued a digital certificate to some particular user. On the other side, the CA4, after receiving a certification from the root CA, that can issue a digital certificate further to a CA called CA3. And then the CA3 may issue the digital certificate to a particular user. Assume that I want to send some information to a particular user in an encrypted form, say Mr. Ahmed, and I want to send him some confidential information after encryption. What I need to do is that I would try to look for the public key of that individual, Mr. Ahmed. One way of finding his particular public key is that I go to a particular machine, a particular public site, also called a key server, and then against the particulars of Mr. Ahmed, that is his name, his address, his ID, I try to find out his digital certificate, or in other words, his public key. I may find on that key server that Mr. Ahmed's certificate has been issued by a certification authority called CA1. In case I consider this certification authority CA1 to be a well-reputed one, I can rely upon this certificate, upon the information contained in it, and then I can utilize the public key printed on it. And by encrypting the message with the help of the public key of Mr. Ahmed, then I can send him the confidential message, and that confidential message he can decrypt with the help of his secret corresponding private key. Just in case that I do not trust this certification authority, CA1, its certificate, then I should look for a digital certificate issued by CA2 to this CA1. If there is a digital certificate confirming the public key of CA1 issued by a CA which is above in the hierarchy, that is CA2, and if that certificate is available, then I can trust the digital certificate issued by CA1 to the user. Furthermore, I'll again have to check the certificate of CA2 also. In order to gain the maximum trust, I would then seek the digital certificate belonging to CA2, which should be issued by the root CA. And once I find that, yes, this particular root CA has issued a digital certificate confirming the public key of CA2, then I can gain trust. I can rely upon the certificate that was issued to the user by the CA1. So therefore, in this particular manner, I would look up the digital certificates. I would go to the key server and I would try to find out all the irrelevant digital certificates. I would check those. In case the chain of these certificates is broken, or some certificate is missing, or some certificate has been issued by a very less reputed certification authority, then I should not trust on the certificate issued to Mr. Ahmed, to a particular individual. On the other hand, in case the chain is maintained and there is no missing link, whenever I travel, whenever I go up the hierarchy, I find each and every certificate there which is confirming the digital certificate, which is confirming the public key of a CA below. Therefore, I can then gain the maximum trust. I can rely upon the certificate issued to a particular user, and I can then make use of that public key which has been certified. In this particular example, the certificate was issued by CA1. So the public key mentioned in the certificate issued by CA1, if the chain is maintained, it is not broken, I should rely upon that public key. I should use that public key and encrypt the message with that public key, and should feel assured that this message would be received by that particular individual, Mr. Ahmed. You may notice one thing here, that all this concept is based upon a web of trust. In other words, it talks about a model of trust. So the more a certification authority is reputed, the more it is well respected, the better reputation it has got, the more would be the trust I would gain from the certificate it has issued. I repeat, with the help of that certificate, the CA would be confirming the public key. Right? So this generates, this gives rise to a model of trust, basically. Now, this is possible that Mr. Ahmed, instead of obtaining the digital certificate from a lower level certification authority, that is CA1 in this particular example, he may want to directly obtain the digital certificate from the root CA itself. So if that is the case, say if Mr. Ahmed goes to VeriSign and requests VeriSign, which is a very well-reputed certification authority, to issue a certificate, then one should feel assured that this certificate is going to be authentic, it should be relied, it should be trusted. In case of VeriSign or in any well-reputed certification authority's case, that authority would do a very proper investigation. It would confirm the name, the ID, the address, all the particulars of a particular individual before issuing him a certificate, before authenticating his public key with the help of its certificate. So the more the certification authority is reputed, the more we assume that it has done all the investigation before issuing the digital certificate confirming the public key of a particular user. I'm emphasizing on this concept because I believe it is a little bit complex, intricate to understand, but I believe inshallah with the help of a few examples we shall be able to gather a clear-cut concept. In order to obtain a digital certificate from a well-reputed certification authority, then we have to pay more to that certification authority, because the certificate issued by such CA carries more weight, it is more trustworthy. So accordingly, the rate for having such a certificate from a well-reputed CA is relatively high. Similarly, there are different types of certificates that a certification authority might issue. There are class A type certificates, class B type digital certificates, class C type. If we request for a class A type certificate to a certification authority, then of course that would carry a more level of trust with it, and the CA might demand more charges for the issuance of such class A type certificate. But once that class A type certificate has been issued to an individual by a well-reputed CA, then the public should have this faith, this trust in mind that this particular public key belongs to this particular individual only. Okay. The position of a certification authority, you may realize, is similar or analogous to a passport office. You can say that a certification authority acts just like a passport office. The passport issued by the passport office attaches a lot of credibility, and it provides the sanction or permission to a particular individual that this individual whose name, whose address, whose picture is appearing on the passport, he is entitled to travel. So before issuing a passport, the passport office would undertake all the relevant inquiry, the investigation, to find out that the identity of this individual who has requested for the passport, that identity is confirmed. And once the passport is there, which is signed, which is authenticated by the passport office, then everybody would come to know that this particular individual, everybody would presuppose that this particular individual has the right to travel. So similarly, in case of digital certificates also, we need a body, an organization, a certification authority which, whose role is similar to the passport office. And by issuing the digital certificate and confirming the public key of a particular individual with the help of that certificate, it in fact provides a level of trust to the public that this key, this public key, is associated with this individual only. Now, there is a logic, there is a reason why this system of digital certificates and certification authorities was conceived, was developed. Basically, it was conceived, it was developed to provide the authentication for the transmission of encrypted messages at a global level. The authentication was believed to be achieved using this setup, this concept. The safest thing to have the public key of an individual without using a certification authority, without using any digital certificate, the safest way, in fact, to get hold of the public key is that we meet that individual personally. We have a physical meeting, and during that, that individual provides his or her public key to us, and then using that public key, then we send him encrypted messages. That is probably the safest way. But there is the other way. When we are operating at a global level, the personal meetings, they are not that convenient, they are not ordinarily possible. Then we have to rely upon this concept of certificates and certification authority. This is probably the best solution under such circumstances. So what happens is that we go to a public site, a key server. We know the particulars of an individual, and against his particulars on that key server, we try to find out his digital certificate. And then we try to judge, evaluate whether the certificate was issued by a reputed CA or not. It has been properly signed by that CA or not. And in case that CA happens to be a trustworthy certification authority, then we can have a trust. We can believe that this key belongs to this individual, and then we can make use of that public key. Now, there is an interesting possibility. It is quite possible that when you go to a key server trying to find out the public key of a particular individual whom you want to send encrypted message, you may be surprised to notice that against that individual's particulars, there are more than one keys available. There are different digital certificates available against the same particulars of that individual. So Mr. Ahmed, having a particular address, having a particular ID information, has got a certain digital certificate issued by a certification authority. And against the same particulars of Mr. Ahmed, there can be some other certificate also having a different public key purportedly associated with the same Mr. Ahmed. So in this fashion, it is possible that there are 4, 5, 6 different public keys, and each has been certified by a particular certification authority. Now, if that is the case, if we discover such an eventuality, we definitely are going to get confused, which is the genuine public key belonging to the Mr. Ahmed we know. Okay, there are 4, 5 different public keys. Which one to pick? Definitely, the one public key is going to be a genuine one. The rest of the public keys, they are going to be fraudulent keys. Somebody might have used the particulars of that gentleman, Mr. Ahmed, and using his particulars, he may have got a digital certificate from a less reputed certification authority and placed it on the key server. Our anxiety is here to find out what is the genuine certificate and what is the genuine public key, so that our message is reliably sent to that Mr. Ahmed whom we want to send this message. Right? So in this particular case, all this concept of certification authorities, digital certificates, that comes into picture, that comes into play, that is there, that has been conceived for this purpose, because I would pick that one public key which has been authenticated by the most well-reputed certification authority. So in case there is VeriSign which has issued the digital certificate to Mr. Ahmed, then I should be assured that this particular public key is the most reliable one. I would discard the rest of the public keys. They have been certified by different other CAs, but they are not comparable to VeriSign. So I would pick that public key which has been attested, certified by VeriSign, and I would discard the rest of the public keys. This is in fact a very common phenomena which is associated with this concept. The creator of the PGP, Pretty Good Privacy Cryptographic System, Mr. Phil Zimmermann, in fact there were more than one keys, 4 or 5 different keys against his name, against his particulars, which were listed on the key server. So even the creator of the system was not spared. There were fraudulent people having fraudulent intentions, and they, using his particulars, got keys registered and got certificates from some less known certification authorities. And now the public is confused. Which is the right public key of Mr. Phil Zimmermann? Then the right approach would be to pick that public key which has been attested by the most reputed certification authority. Another example is that on the key server, there were more than one keys, different keys, in the name of Mr. Bill Clinton, the former US president. So one was confused, what is the real public key of Mr. Bill Clinton in this case? The objective before the fraudulent persons who try to get the fake, the fraudulent keys registered on the key server and obtain a digital certificate in this regard, their objective in fact is to intercept or receive the messages which in fact are intended to be delivered to a particular individual. They want to intercept all such messages. They want to receive those messages for a malicious, for a fraudulent purpose, so that they can read all such messages which were in fact directed to a particular individual by the sender side. There is a legal solution to this problem, and in most countries there have been laws which have been enacted which basically aim at attaching certain liability upon the certification authorities if the certification authorities, they do not do proper care while issuing the certificates, the fraudulent certificates, then in under certain circumstances they may be held legally liable for that. Now, despite this loophole that fraudulent keys can be created and they can be registered, despite this loophole, this system is believed to be the best system. This web of trust is believed to be the best solution for providing authenticity in relation to encrypted messages. Assume that I'm sitting in Pakistan and I want to send an encrypted message digitally signed to a person who is sitting in Canada. Assume that I want to enter into a contract with that person and I want to send him the terms of that contract, and I want to make the terms of the contract confidential using encryption. It would be very inconvenient, impractical, and difficult if I presume that I can interact with him personally, I can physically meet him, or there are other ways of establishing contact with him using which I can receive his public key. A more rational, more practical, a more easy approach in this example, in this scenario would be that I make use of this system of certificates and certification authorities. Right? So a person who is sitting so remote, I cannot expect that I can meet him, I can easily establish contact with him. A far more easy approach, practical approach is that I go to the key server. I know the particulars of that individual. Against his particulars, I try to trace, try to find out his digital certificate, which would be bearing his public key. And I would then judge whether there is a well-reputed certification authority which has issued that gentleman this certificate confirming his public key. If that is the case, if I'm satisfied with this arrangement, then I can always make use of that public key, and using that, then I can encrypt the terms of the contract, and I can then pass on to that individual. That individual, using his corresponding private key, can decrypt the terms of such a contract. So in this fashion, this system, the system of certification authorities, it becomes very vital, it becomes very useful, and that is the reason that this system is still prevailing and is also growing with days. Just to carry our discussion further, I would emphasize again on the thing that the system of certification authorities, that system is global in nature. Without compromising the authenticity part of a user, it becomes a very global sort of a thing. So if I am in Pakistan and I want to exchange certain encrypted information with somebody in America, then it is so easy, so convenient for me that using the particulars of that individual, I trace his public key and then send him the encrypted messages. So wherever we are aiming at a global level, we cannot expect that we can physically meet with the individual who's being far away, very remote. Then using this particular setup, we can exchange the encrypted messages and we can enter into transactions. So in our today's lecture, let's try to review what we have studied. We have discussed as to what is a digital certificate, what are certification authorities, how do they operate, how do they function, what is the hierarchy of certification authorities, and what is the need to have this system, this setup of certification authorities and the digital certificates, etc. And we also got this notion that basically this system aims at providing us a model of trust. So we rely upon that public key which has been attested by a well-reputed certification authority for encryption purposes. In our subsequent lecture, inshallah, we shall be viewing some examples to understand how the digital signature technology works, how we use this pair of public key and private key, and with the help of these, how we can create the digital signatures and how the authenticity and integrity and non-repudiation they are achieved. Remember, we talked about these terms earlier. So that would be inshallah the agenda of our next lecture. Now the time for your today's lecture is over, so inshallah we shall be meeting in our coming lecture very soon. Till then, Allah Hafiz.